Rezzolla, who's going to talk about learning from merging binary black holes with waveforms and electromagnetic counterparts.
So, as a matter of fact, my title was longer in the program, and I had to drop one part. It is non-linear in fact, and that's because I realized I'm preparing my talk that if I want to talk about all these things, I don't really have the time. So what I would be talking about is waveforms that are line binaries. Then I would say something about electromagnetic counterparts. Something I meant to say, but I don't really have the time, is modeling the final state from initial conditions. So I will just make a little propaganda here. This is something that numerical relativity has done for people interested in this type of problem. We do have now expressions, analytic, algebraic expressions, that allow you to go from any binary initial data in terms of mass ratio and spin orientation and know what is going to be the final spin and the final recoil velocity. This is to a position of a few percent, less than 1% in some cases. So it's certainly something that can be used for astrophysics and cosmology. First of all, let me say something about waveforms. What I'm considering are binary black holes, which have equal mass and have spins that are parallel or anti-parallel to the orbital angular momentum. So let's assume that the orbital angular momentum is in the positive z direction. So I'm thinking about objects that are like either like this or like this, or they are mixed, and the size of the spin can be different. All of these objects would fill up one quadrant of this diagram, this upper triangle, essentially, where I have the dimensionless spin A1 and A2, and so you can think that objects along this line, this southwest, north, east diagonal, these are equal spins, and these are both objects that have the spin downwards, these are the objects that have the spin upwards. These are instead objects that have the spin one up and one down, but they are the same, and then you have all the other possibilities. Let me show you what happens if you consider this object here. So this is down, down, with respect to the orbital angular momentum. You start from a given distance, and that's the waveform. You consider this object here, no spins, or if you want, as I'll show you, this is the same as if you had the spins up and down, and you obtain this waveform. Or you can think about this other object, where the spins are up, and you obtain yet another waveform. So here the system is the same, has the same mass, same initial separation. It's just the coupling between spin, orbits, and spin-spin that does the difference. And so why are we interested in this type of objects? Well, aligned spins are interesting because, first of all, they're clean, in the sense that they do not precess, and so all of the complication of couplings, spin-orbit and spin-spin, disappears. They also may be preferred in nature because, you know, we have heard a number of reasons why we expect them, that these torques will align the spins. And we also know that these objects lead to small recoil velocity. And we know we observe most galaxies having a black hole at their inside. So most likely that means that the recoils are in general small, and therefore indirectly, maybe this is the way nature presents its binaries. And as I'll say more, this is probably the system that we will detect first, at least for ground based. So once you have this scenario, you want to ask some questions. How well can we distinguish this object from another object in this diagram? If we don't have templates which are for spinning binaries, can we still detect them? And out of this, which one is the system which is the loudest, and by how much? So you can see these are very simple, basic questions that we're trying to find an answer to. How do you do this? Well, you calculate things with numerical relativity, but you need long waveforms, and for this you need to have a stitching with post-Newtonian approximation. We do this stitching in the frequency domain, and as is shown in this figure, you don't quite see it. There is a green line, which is the post-Newtonian signal. There is a blue line, which is instead the numerical relativity signal, which and cuts off at the quasi-normal frequency. And so we just produce an object which is the stitching of the green and the blue, and this is then our quantity from which we calculate the signal-to-noise ratio. If you want to do this in time, this is very complicated because you have to make sure that the phase is correct and so on. But if you're interested just in calculating this number, then all of this information is irrelevant, and you can do it much more easily. So just to make sure, you know, with me, the two only parameters I have in the system are the two spins, the dimensionless spins, because I have equal mass systems.
Could you clarify why phase is irrelevant?
Because
usually we think phase information is absolutely crucial in a long waveform.
That's because you want to do template matching. I'm not doing template matching here. I just want to calculate this object.
Okay. Well, you're assuming you have done.
Yes.
Yes.
So distinguishability. So I want to take a waveform, say this one, for non-spinning black holes, and compare it with any other in this plane, and ask myself, how different are they? In order to do this, I calculate an overlap, so it's just a scalar product between two waveforms. I normalize them, and then I take, I calculate the scalar product with respect to a given detector. So this S is a measure of the distinguishability relative to a detector, of course. Then I can calculate this, essentially, I can maximize the overlap by changing the time of arrival and the phase of the two waveforms and obtain these two numbers. So number which are border one means that the two waveforms are very similar. Okay, so let's look at this straight line here, which is almost one everywhere. This is the comparison between S0, which is this point here, this non-spinning, with U8, and U8 is this object here. So you can and what I have here is the mass, because the mass is brought in by the fact that my detector is sensitive differently for different masses. And you can see, essentially, this is always of the order of 1. Actually, it's very close to 1, to less than a part of in a thousand. But that means, essentially, that my detector will not be able to distinguish any object along this diagonal, this northwest diagonal. If I compare S0 with S-8, which is this object here, I see that I'll be able to distinguish them. I will be able to distinguish also S0 by S8, which is this object here. And if I compare these two guys, then of course they are very different. Okay? So this is showing us that there is, first of all, a problem, and it is that I can't distinguish these binaries. So a binary which has zero spin and a binary which has arbitrary spin, but they are opposite and equal, are indistinguishable to the precision of these instruments. And to the fact that I'm using here just the lowest order information on the waveform. If I were to put in more information on higher harmonics, then these numbers would be slightly less. But it's still very small and very close to 1.
Is this an artifact of the fact that we're using equal mass?
Well, it's not an artifact. It's the consequence of having an equal mass system.
Or, you know, phrase it differently. Suppose you wouldn't have you wouldn't have equal mass. How sharp is the sort of this maximum there that is around the 1?
Well, so I can't quantify this, but of course any difference in the system would then, you know, go in the direction of helping you distinguish things. Detectability, that is the question. If I use this waveform here, can I find any of these other systems? And this is shown here. So this line, which you hardly see, this is the threshold for detectability. Anything which is below this cannot be detected. Anything which is above this can be detected. And here my ordering parameter is the total spin, so A1 plus A2 divided by 2. And you can see that essentially, so what I'm doing is I'm using a non-spinning template and I'm trying to see if I can find a match which is larger than 0.965, which is this line here. And you can see that if I'm in this neighborhood, so near the non-spinning, then I can get and detect the waveforms, which is good because it is exactly the template that we are using nowadays. So nowadays we can detect spinning binaries even with non-spinning templates. But there is also bad news, and it is 50% of the signal is lost. And that's why it's very important things like phenomenological waveforms of aligned spin binaries are actually implemented in the search line. Another question is loudness, okay? If you ask yourself this question, can you tell me which of the systems, like this or like this, is the loudest? If you think a bit hard, you would find the answer. And of course, it's this system over here. Why? Well, it simply has the largest total angular momentum. We'll have to get rid of it, and that means we'll span a large number of orbits, and therefore we'll emit more gravitational waves and energy. This is shown in this diagram here, where I have the mass of the system, and I have again this parameter, which is just the sum of the spins. So let's just go from minus point A, which will be considered plus point A, and you see that this curve grows quadratically. That means that systems which have spins down have about a signal-to-noise ratio which is a third of these other objects over here. So that means that will be 3 times as loud than the anti-aligned, and that means 30 times more likely to be detected. And this is why I was saying this is probably this system here, up, is most likely the first object we will see with the ground-based detectors.
Which are, what's the ratio? Of, does it look like a third?
Yeah, it doesn't look like a third.
I'm pretty sure it is a third. I don't think I have
15,000 to 50. Okay.
A third more.
Huh?
Increases by a third.
So the signal-to-noise ratio here is 3 times this one. Okay, I can show you what this
is.
Let me get you to that later.
Yeah,
it's true. It's this perspective.
If
you pull that back.
Yeah, because zero is fairly high up, isn't it, actually?
Yeah.
Okay. Now that you've convinced me for a second, let me just point out a much more serious problem. And it is here I have these numbers I'm collecting here represent all of this ordered parameter, but this number is essentially picking up numbers anywhere from this space. I have about 20 or so binaries which have evolved, and I'm ordering them just in terms of this parameter. So in principle, this could be not a smooth surface, it could be full of bumps and maximum, and it's not. So this is really telling you that this system, which has 2 free parameters, and has effectively just 1 parameter, is a total spin. And so again, this is going into direction, and it's difficult to distinguish 2 objects, A1 and A2, which will give you the same A. This means that essentially we have to do a better job in trying to pull out more information from our waveforms. One way of doing this is using higher harmonics, and this is something we're working on. I have to switch now to the next part of my talk, and it is electromagnetic counterparts. So, as we see, there is a pre-merger and a post-merger picture of this process. And what has been done so far is, in numerical ability at least, so by that I mean by taking full Anselm's equations or relativistic aerodynamics, if nothing else, and see what happens. And people have considered isotropic distribution of hot and dense gas surrounding the binary, and there's been 2 works here by Tanya Borde and et al., and then Faris et al. And I think Tamara will discuss this in the afternoon, so I will not say much about this. But let me just say that numerical relativity has done this problem. As suppose we have a binary system 3 orbits away from merger, let's put it in a glass cloud and see what happens. And Tamara will say what happens. Another approach which has been done is instead of considering a distant circumbinary disk, and just assume that the coupling takes place either through a plasma or some electromagnetic fields. And this is the work we've actually done. So the picture is very simple, and it's been discussed many, many times. You have that the 2 objects will have their little accretion disks. And then imagine that they also have some magnetic field which is threading the disk and then is also permeating the space in between. And these objects will merge. You will have a circumbinary disk. We know that the circumbinary disk will decouple when the binary evolves very rapidly. And so at the end of the day, what you can really think is a well-posed problem, although maybe not a realistic one, is you can think, well, what happens if you have a binary system where you have a black hole swimming into a magnetic field, and whether this will produce something which is detectable. So for this, you have to solve the Anselm's equation together with the Maxwell equation. That's exactly what we've done. You don't see much here, I don't know why, but let me first tell you that something happens even if you have a single black hole in a uniform magnetic field. This is what happens. You have the magnetic field lines are pinched, and you produce an electric field, just if you have rotation. If you don't have rotation, you just have the pinching of the magnetic field line. And if you have a twisted black hole spin with respect to the, so here you clearly see where the spin is, then you have this complicated field structure which is produced. This is actually very simple to understand if you use the membrane paradigm. So this is essentially the same picture I've shown you before, but in a 2D, so you can see the actual vector field line. So this is a magnetic field. You can see that there is a little pinch here. You don't quite see because of the light. Seems to be too much. But essentially what you do is when you have a black hole which is rotating in a magnetic field, this creates affecting charges at the poles, and this then, of course, will produce a quadrupolar electric field, which is the one I was showing. Now, this is a single black hole. If you have two black holes, you will do, again, you will introduce some effective charges. And now these are produced by the equivalent of a Hall effect. So essentially, you have a dipolar charge, and you have like two dipoles now, electric dipoles, which are moving around. And you can solve the equivalent problem in electromagnetism, then you know we produce electromagnetic waves which have a quadrupolar nature. So at this point, you really should know what to expect. But let me show you this in a movie, which you probably won't see. So on the left, you have electromagnetic waves. On the right, you have gravitational waves. And the system just does what we are used to do. Now you will just inspire and merge, and then you will see that together with the gravitational radiation, is going to be an electromagnetic radiation in terms of pointing flux, which is this one here. And then, of course, they have very similar structure because, as I was said, they have the same quadrupolar nature. You can ask yourself how similar the two things are. These are the gravitational waves for three different binaries. So this is non-spinning, and then these are the other ones which I've shown you. This is up and down, 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 up, up. And this is the corresponding electromagnetic waves. You calculate electromagnetic waves by looking at a Faraday tensor and just projecting on the null tensor. But for what is of interest here, let's say that there is a large similarity. Essentially, you're producing electromagnetic waves which are just the copy of the gravitational ones. The phase evolution is exactly the same. This is the phase evolution. This is the amplitude evolution. Psi 4 is gravitational waves. Phi 2 is essentially the component of the electric field. And you can see that the amplitude evolution is just the same. You have this very steep rise, and then you have the quasi normal mode going down. And the phase evolution is also the same. So essentially, once you see gravitational waves, you would also see electromagnetic waves, because the two are mirroring each other. Of course, you want to understand whether this is detectable. And so you calculate how much energy is lost. Sorry, this is a mistake. It's 10 to the 6. And it's 10 to the 11, 10 to the minus 11. So 100th of a billionth of the mass of the system is lost in this way. If you ask yourself, well, how much mass do I lose in gravitational waves normally, that's about 5%. So the ratio between these two objects is 9 orders of magnitude. You are 9 orders of magnitude more efficient in getting rid of gravitational of energy through gravitational waves than through this pointing flux.
So what is the comparative efficiency in detecting that?
Sorry, say that again?
You know, if you're talking about detectability, one thing is to emit 10 to the minus 9 energy. The other thing is how much better are we in detecting electromagnetic radiation. Right?
Yes, so that's written down here. But let me first point out that all of this scales quadratically with the magnetic field strength, of course. And so you can see that this is undetectable for realistic field strength, but detectable for unrealistic field strength. It's a different way of putting negative results. But I think, to answer your question, you really have to consider this electromagnetic wave that produced at frequencies which are ultra-low radio frequencies. This is essentially the orbital period of the system. So a direct detection is very, very difficult, if not impossible at all. I don't think any instrument can go that low frequency.
The waves don't propagate.
Yeah.
The plasma frequency of whatever is surrounding it, and the plasma frequency of the interstellar medium in our galaxy.
Yeah, you would be shielded.
So they won't go through it.
If you have a field this intense, you're guaranteed to have a lot of plasma in the neighborhood, which throws it over into the MHD state.
That's right. So that's where you can play. The strategies that. Well, this exercise at least shows you that you have a lot of energy, because it's a lot of energy. It might sound small, but it's a lot of energy. And then if you can tap this energy and put it into something else, maybe into the plasma which is near there, or in the electron. In the accretion accretion flow. Maybe then there is something you can do with this.
Sorry, how much is this energy compared to a supernova, for example? So if we dump this energy in the center of the galaxy, how does it compare to a supernova?
So, I mean, so if you have...
A supernova is 0.5 solar masses C squared, right?
Yeah.
A total
so
energy.
So this is 10 to the 6. This is 10 to the 6.
So, so it's roughly about the same energy you see in a core collapse supernova, roughly.
In electromagnetic?
Yeah.
Because it's neutrino.
Yeah, that's right.
So this energy would be simply trapped. There'd be some indirect way of seeing it.
Yeah, so this is the next part of the picture, you know, trying to see how this would then feed back on whatever. Let's say the direct evidence of this, the direct detection of this is very unlikely. I need to move on. How much do I have? So, but there is the other picture, the other side of the picture is the post-merge. This work that is done mostly by Lingle Zanotti, who is here. So, we know what we're talking about. Well, suppose that the black hole is recalling, what is the effect it has on the accreting matter? There's been a lot of work done in this respect already. Let's say we've done this, the pros of our approach is that we've done this in general. And we think this is important because when you have accretion flow near a black hole, even though you're talking about effects on very large scales, the accretion flow near a black hole is very sensitive to velocities, and therefore it's essential that you try to do this at least in special relativity or in general relativity. We try to use self-consistent initial data, so we use tori in equilibrium of different sizes, either about 100m or 1000m, just to see what is the difference, and different values of the black hole spin. What are the cons is that we are restricted to 2D, and therefore we consider kicks just in the plane, and we ignore magnetic fields and radial transport. And as Julian has pointed out, this is a very important omission there. So let me just show you what happens if you have a small disk, so you can see small because it's about 100m only, and then recoil of 500 km per second. The time here is in days, because I'm assuming there is a 10 to the 6 solar mass. You produce this whack into the orbiting material, you see the orbit, will try to adjust themselves to the recoiling black hole, and wait long enough and you end up with something which has a much less degree in anisotropy in much less non-axisymmetric pattern. Let me just move on. So this is the density profile at two different times. So this is hours 5, 50, 100. And you heard that there are shocks. As a matter of fact, there are shocks there, but you have to look for them very carefully, otherwise you don't see them. And with Olindo, we have, when solving this problem, you have to come up and find a shock detector, and that's the result of the shock detector. It's a shock detector which is based on some Riemann inequalities that you can define in special relativity, and which allow you to determine the condition where in the flow there is a shock. So although you don't see them because they're not very apparent, there are shocks, and these are the one mark. So what is it we find? Essentially, we do see spiral shocks, and these propagate outwards. This is essentially what you would expect. You see that at the beginning, there is the object is almost, the shock is almost axisymmetric. This is because the first thing that the disk does is react to the mass loss. This black hole is also lost some mass, 5%, and that's why essentially it's just expanding and producing this axisymmetric shock. But then as the black hole moves, and then it will really produce an asymmetry. We've seen essentially what other people have seen already, and that is either in collisionless disks or in Newtonian fluid disks. Something else which happens if you have a large disk and you have a large recoil. This recoil is not realistic. We just put it in because it gives some interesting dynamics. This is what I show here. So this is really a very large kick. And what you will see is that after a while, there is a cavity which is produced near the black hole, and this is a quasi-stationary cavity. It looks almost like a wing shape, and this is really stationary. There are occasional flow of matter, and we have looked at other people's simulations of the same process, and they also there is the same stationary feature. I think it's got to do with the fact that you know this is a kind of Bondi Hoyle accretion, so moving black hole into a medium which has a large angular momentum and produces this object. So this is, if you wish, interesting astrophysical relativity type of application. What are the conclusions? Well, if you have large disks and kicks of about 500 kilometers per second, the spiral structure is formed, but it's short-lived. Okay, so this is the sort of realistic scenario. Okay, large disks and 500 kilometers per second. So this doesn't last very long. If you have very large disks, the spiral is not present, but you do have strong shocks and complicated dynamics which comes up. Easy to show that we've done things with different spins, and you can see that essentially they are very similar with the mass accretion weight. Because of our setup, this is super Eddington by far. So you shouldn't really look at the numbers, which are not so important. What would be more interesting, if you wish, is the behavior with respect to different spins. So this is the spin, and you see essentially the mass accretion weight at 5 days, because you have to set up a time, is decreasing with spin. And different lines here again show the mass accretion rate for different velocity. And of course you obtain the obvious, if you have small velocity it will take a longer time for the mass accretion rate to go up. But this behavior is non-linear. So the time and the amount of matter that you gain is not a linear function of the recoil velocity. So in principle, if you can deduce what is the, so there is this correlation which could be used in some way or another from the observations. The luminosity, this is a very important outcome of all of these simulations, and what people have done, this is a very popular choice, is to use Bremsstrahl and radiation. Just have an expression of this type and calculate what is the luminosity. And you get very large numbers, and these are, of course, very nice if you want to publish a paper, but they are not realistic. Because if you calculate the cooling time, you find that it's a few seconds. So essentially, in a few seconds, you emit all of the energy which is available, and that's clearly not reasonable. You can try and do something better, and so just because you have m dot, you say, well, I have m dot, I'm assuming an eta, which is a conservative one, and I get an accretion luminosity. And again, this is something you can do, but because you are super Eddington, and you are super Eddington because you're not doing any radiative transfer, again, you're getting an answer which is as good as your assumption. Another way of doing this is what Andrew was saying as isothermal evolution. So essentially, assume that any compression is dissipated in radiation. This is tricky to do in relativity, but you can do it. And that's what we've done. And that's, let's say, the most realistic estimate we have at the moment without radiative transfer. Concentrate on the red line. You have peak luminosity of about 10 to 43 Earth per second, which goes up in a few tens of days, and then levels up and stays constant for the remaining time. Okay, summary. First of all, and this is something I haven't talked to you about, I've just said it's done, so use it. We can map the initial binary to a final, to a percent precision. We think aligned binaries are reasonably understood. There is a degenerate space of parameters. 50% of spinning binaries can be detected as non-spinning, and up are 3 times louder than down. That is 30 times more likely to be detected. When you look at electromagnetic counterparts, essentially a lot of work has already been done, but it's mostly what is doable with our codes. We've shown that electromagnetic fields around black hole can be dragged and lead to electromagnetic radiation, but the losses are pretty small for realistic magnetic fields. And recoil-induced perturbation can lead to large and likely detectable mass accretion rates. More physics, of course, is needed. And we need to go from this paradigm, let's do what is doable, from let's do what is realistic. And of course, this is part of our learning process. One thing that is clear to me, at least, is that our ability of computing electromagnetic counterparts is just proportional and as good as our models. So as long as we don't have prescriptions for what is realistic initial data, then we can only do clearly we need more astrophysics inputs in this. Thank you.
So let me start with one quick question. Your small disk is a 500 kilometer per second kick. In the paper, you described this as having a constant angular momentum profile.
That's
so
right.
That topology is pretty well unstable, right?
That's right. And we do see the topology of pretty well unstability.
Okay. So we should focus more on the larger disk results that you have.
Yes.
Okay. Other questions?
The 3D plot that you showed of least signal to noise ratio as a function of the spin and the total system mass, what distance were you assuming for the system? Because you showed some astonishingly high signal to noise ratios, 50,000 to 1.
I think that the.
Was this kid the
100? I don't recall. I think this must have been at least 100 megaparsec, but this could have been even more than this. It's in the paper. But,
maybe I missed it, but about your recoil simulation picture, initially you said that it's important to do the calculation in GR, but then we showed that the results are similar to the Newtonian one, which is probably expected at 100 for the radius.
Well, it depends what... So if you want a qualitative answer, then of course Newtonian gravity might be a good approximation to your problem. But this is something you can assess a posteriori. You can't ever say that a Newtonian treatment of aerodynamics near a black hole is adequate up until you've done a general relativistic calculation and reach the conclusion that to the position of your choice,
you
have a similar answer.
Like the 100 for the radio, you can quantitatively say how big it's going to be.
But as I say, there are two things which are important. One is the gravity, and so being a certain distance from the black hole plays a role, but the gravity might say is not so important. But the other thing is the velocity. If you have relativistic velocity, you can't think that Newtonian aerodynamics is adequate. That's why we don't do Newtonian aerodynamics. In addition, the black hole is moving. Initially, it's at 100 Schwarzschild radii. At the end of the simulation, and during the simulation, the black hole meets the matter, enters into the disk. At that point, you know, what do you say? I do my calculation just up until it is 100, and then I stop. I think if one has the ability...
That's because you do it into deep. If you have kicks up.
Well, but that's my model, and as I said, it's probably the most likely one.
Okay, we can continue discussion. Ed has a couple of announcements, but let's thank Luciano.